Our afternoon will start with a lecture by Thierry Paul, who is a mathematician and a friend in Paris, working at CNRS in a laboratory of Paris Sorbonne. As a mathematician, he has been mostly working in mathematics of quantum mechanics. His talk will be causality, determinism, and all that, a quantum entanglement.
Thank you, Giuseppe, for this, as usual, very nice introduction. And as I used to say, I'm very happy to be here. Let me be serious. I'm very happy to be here. I learned a lot of things already here since this morning. You asked me, I'm the organizer, asked me a task which is a little bit difficult to talk about, to introduce people, non-specialists and not physicists, and maybe most of you not mathematicians, to quantum mechanics, and to do that by looking at the causality aspects and context also. So I will try to do it. Let me say first that there are at least two ways of talking about mathematics that I'm about quantum mechanics that I'm not going to follow. The first one is usual object of classical culture, classical physics, and to quantize them, to put them in the framework of quantum mechanics. And I don't like this view because this drives you usually to paradoxes, the fake moths, I should say, because they are fake and famous at the same time, paradoxes of quantum mechanics. There is no paradox in quantum mechanics. And the other way is to show pictures. If you buy, by chance, at random, a book on quantum mechanics in a library, you'll have a lot of pictures which are supposed to show you quantum mechanics, but these pictures are wrong because you cannot watch a quantum system. You can't watch a quantum system, not because quantum system, at least isolated quantum system, are small. They are not so small anymore. For example, in Laboratoire Castler-Brossel in Paris, physicists excite atoms of rubidium in such a way that, with quotation marks, they occupy a volume which is of the size of a small bacteria. So a single atom can have the volume of a small bacteria. It's a kind of equivalent of the blob to atomic physics, you know. So this is not a problem. The problem is that, and I'm going to use for the first time the word of context, is that the quantum system is in its own context, its own space that you cannot reach. In fact, the only way of reaching it consists in making a measurement. And as soon as you make a measurement, you have two effects. The first effect is that you destroy it, not release the system, but that is the state in which the system was, so all parameters. And secondly, you get an answer which is totally random. I'm going to explain all that, and it's just warming up. And the fact that the answer is random created a lot of problems in some people. Since quantum mechanics was invited, as a mechanist was invited in 1925, so almost one century ago, because there are people who think that science must predict, basically. And a science doesn't predict, it's not a science. Of course, again, I'm quite convinced that everybody is convinced that this ideology, because it's really a true ideology, it's wrong, but it's still very, very developed, and this is why, and it will be my first slide, why quantum mechanics is a little bit still painful. And I'm going to illustrate this by just to trying to catch you familiar with my talk by taking three or four extracts from the very nice motivation text for the conference that we all get, and make some comments in the quantum direction. Okay, so why quantum mechanics is nowadays painful, and this reminds me this quotation from the 60s in the French radio that I let you reading. So the first extract I put is, you wrote, and the organizer wrote, physics was framed causality with rigorous and unifying conservation principles. This is true for classical physics, not really to quantum physics, and I will show you that This is not exactly the case, and we'll discuss this if I have time. And maybe this is the first link with biology, so to speak. Now, we wrote that you presented, I'll let you read the concept of causality, context, etc. My idea in this talk will be to present you that there are several quantum contexts, basically two, but several, with some of them, one context will be in interaction with us, another won't be. But once again, this is just to pose some problems. What I said exactly 1 minute ago, the result of a measurement has no cause. So, because it's totally random, but it's not random like you get random from a lot of information, for example, like in the Boltzmann theory of gases, where you know that everybody is working like you wish, but you're not able to compute everything. It's a totally interesting end determinism which gives you the result of a measurement. There is absolutely no algorithm, nothing can explain you that. So this is really what I would say, that there is no cause. But at the same time, therefore, you don't have any irreversibility. You know also, I will show you that you don't have any cloning, which is a bit strange, but I will explain you why. And finally, the last thing which seems to be maybe like a paradox is that, so, you know, computer cannot do anything to predict the result of a measurement. It's interesting to run. There is nothing to compute, nothing to do. You are really at the basic of microscopic matter, so nothing can do. And at the same time, quantum mechanics can help a lot of computing. So this is a very strange way, no help of computer, but the help of quantum mechanics in quantum computer. Okay, so what I would like to tell you, and then I will enter to the interior of the subject. Contextual indeterminism and causality can merge by lack of information. In fact, by unlack of information, sorry. The second question I'm looking at is how can interesting indeterminism and causality merge themselves? I'm going to be a little bit fast on this, because basically I said it already. So one thing I'm going to try to develop is that a single result of a measurement is not an effect, it doesn't have any cause, but I will see you that it can be the cause of a new measurement itself. It seems very complicated, but the formalism I will use will show it directly. And with this is a little bit a link with what you mentioned in the text about flipping cause and effects. And one consequence of this is that Zeno was right. In fact, the Zeno paradox is not a paradox in quantum mechanics. And indeed, if Zeno was quantum, he would try to put his arrow on the wall, and the arrow will never arrive to the wall. So I will explain you all that. So question of methodology. I will present quantum mechanics outside any classical reference. I think, as I mentioned already, it's important to do that. To present quantum mechanics out of classical mechanics, would be a little bit like looking at evolution of spaces out of evolution of something which doesn't evolve, out of evolution of stones. Maybe the contrary is true. Out of evolution of human of beings, you can have evolution of stone in Pompeii, for example, because everything was reduced to stone. But the other way is certainly not possible. In fact, the important fact is that the language, this was a question I wanted to ask to Giuseppe, but maybe I will do it tomorrow or some other place. Is there a language in biology? There is a language in quantum mechanics, but it's not only that his language is mathematical, like Galileo say, in a certain sense. I mean, maybe he didn't say that exactly, but the Copernic revolution was to say that physics needs mathematics. But what I believe very strongly is that the language of quantum is exactly mathematics. It's not a question of using mathematics, because there is no other way of expressing quantum mechanics than by its contents in mathematics. Because as soon as you talk about an electron, a spin, as you use this kind of things, you finally use things which remind the classical aspect, and then you get to the wall immediately. You know? So the good news is that these mathematics needed for quantum mechanics are very simple, much more simpler than what we need for classical mechanics. We got used to classical mechanics, but to understand what the material point is, the point is extremely complicated. Now you need to extend to the simplest operation you have when you go to high school, that is addition and multiplication. You have to transform them a little bit. This is why I know now is around, this plus circuit and this multiplication circuit. But everybody can understand the plus circuit and multiplication circuit if you understand the multiplication and addition of numbers. And this we proved with Giuseppe many years ago when we gave some lectures at École Normale, where I presented the formalism from the beginning to philosophers who have nothing, absolutely no culture in physics, and you did the same with the Gödel theorem. And all that was possible just by taking from the scratch. So keep quiet. I won't do mathematics, it was just kidding, but I will show you that this object, this new object, this new addition, and this new multiplication, which are no equivalent in classical physics, can be illustrated very powerful way by everybody's life experience. And I will take, so maybe I will try to attract you immediately. I will talk about 3D cinemas, for example, in traffic light. I will show you that 3D cinema and traffic light are a perfect illustration of quantum mechanics. Okay. So I'm going to start by talking about, in fact, biology, then by talking about Schrödinger, but not the Schrödinger that you like in biology, not the Schrödinger of what is life, but the Schrödinger torturing its pets, its famous cat of Schrödinger. And I'm going to show you how, in fact, exactly the question of language is important. The sentence by Raymond de Vos is a French humorist, I don't know, it's something which seems completely surrealistic, you know, the whole without anything around. It's totally, in fact, it's exactly how Dirac invented antimatter. First of all, it was a hole in something, and then something disappeared, so there's a hole in nothing. Okay, I think I don't have to mention again the Schrödinger cat. Everybody knows about this. It's a famous story of a cat which should be alive and dead at the same time, patati patata, and then you make a measurement, you give poison, or I don't know. I mean, this is a mess, absolutely. And we realize Schrödinger did that for fun. And then he took this amplification by popularization. In fact, the Schrödinger cat is not alive and dead at the same time, because it doesn't mean anything. It's not more alive or dead, because you know that either you're alive, either you're dead. But it's something else. And precisely, the something else will be that the Schrödinger cat is alive, is in a state which is alive plus, and here you recognize the plus I introduced before, plus dead. So what is this plus, in fact? This seems mysterious like this. It corresponds to the extension of the space. And how do we, of course, mathematics are very simple on that, but what is the reason, the strong, according to me, feeling about that? It's an imaginary space out of the space that we know very well. And the 3D does exactly that. What is the 3D cinema? You have a cinema context, which is what you see, which is in 3D. When you look at Dial M for Murder, by example, by Hitchcock, you know, the, in French is, what is in French? Le crime était presque parfait. You have the finger of Grace Kelly, which tried to grab a knife like this to kill the person trying to kill him. And you have the person already on your nose. Except that if you do that, you have nothing of see. But it's really, you really see a 3D movie. But in fact, what the reality is that you have a 2D screen, like this wall, exactly. Nothing is free. But on these 2D, but on these 2Ds, you have two pictures which are projected, like the dead and the life. And these two pictures, the superposition of these two pictures, thanks to your glasses, which send one of the picture in one of the eye, and thanks to the superposition material, which is your brain behind, makes you see in 3D. So it's exactly what does mathematically this extension of the space, instead of having just number, which I take complex, I should have taken real or rational, whatever you want. Is it okay, Luca? You pass to, you double the dimension, that is, you pass to C to the square, that is C cross C. And a vector space will be just a set of this kind of, you know, symbol, which is A and B, like this, represent like this, where A and B are two usual numbers, but you have a structure because you put them in a column like this, you know. And what is the addition now, this plus like this? Well, it consists by taking one, another one, and you just add components by components. You add the upper level and you have the lower level, and you add this by the usual addition of numbers. It's nothing more than this, like that. So in this case, what is the state alive is the vector, which is one and zero, dead, which is zero and one, and the alive plus dead is just the vector with dead and alive. It's something which is not in our, this is not, which is not a number, that is not something that we can touch, it's a vector, but it's constructed very simply. But now, when you measure, and what is, if I continue and I will be finished my 3D cinemas picture, what means to make measurements? I remember that to measure, when you measure a Schrodinger cat, you get alive or dead, because it's only two only possibility. Well, I don't know if this experience, when you go to see a 3D movie, you do that. When you do that, up the third dimension disappears immediately. It's very beautiful to do that, you know. You do that, whoop, everything is projected in two dimensions. If you do the other one, everything is projected in two dimensions. That is, you recover the two pictures which are projected on the screen just by effectuating a measure, that is, by looking at one eye only and one eye. This is these 3D things, I think it's important because we got use of seeing the third dimension on the two-dimension picture, for example, in photography, you know. But when photography was born, in the first daguerreotype, it was a serious problem. People didn't like the fact that we were representing things on the two-dimensional level. And you have in 3D daguerreotypes from, I think, 1848 or 1849 already. That is two images, because you don't need glasses. You put the two images that have been taken by two objectives, a little bit separated, likewise. You put a piece of paper here. You do that, you have two images here and here. You focalize at infinity, and whoop, you see immediately the third dimension arriving. So it's nothing more complicated than that. That's it. And that's all, in fact. By this picture, this image, you have exactly the way that quantum mechanics construct for you something which is not accessible to you and would access, necessity to take one of the part, either alive, either dead, and not the two at the same time. So, this is why I wrote here, inside cinema quantum context, standard causality. So in the 3D cinema, you have a certain causality. Why? In the quantum side, you will have the Schrödinger equation, which is an equation exactly than the one that Giuseppe was talking about. This is an equation, and Newton tells us you have to solve equations. Schrödinger equation tells you the propagation of the wave function. The causality is perfect. If you start by an initial condition, you get what you get at the time t, etc., etc. Well, I mean, in a cine, it's Hollywood, you have a narrative way, very usual, etc. But the quantum context is unreachable. This is what I was saying in the beginning. You don't have access to the true state of your system. You have to measure. And when you measure, you just project on one of the two factors around you, you sign plus. In fact, if I say something, we are cyclops. That is, we have only one eye, and we try to see something where you need two eyes because you have to use your glasses. So by this, I try to convince you that it's not so unfamiliar to think about measurements as something giving you some part of the information which is contained in your system, and that it seems that it destroys causality because the result you will get will be random. And let me comment on this because, and after I will maybe be a little bit more serious. Measurement has also something to do with you're in an Italian restaurant and you don't understand Italian and there is no written card. So you have somebody arrive, tell you, oggi come primi abbiamo matriciano, you don't understand anything. And then you try to remember one word and you say one word and then the waiter leaves and he brings back you a result which is totally random because you don't know what you have ordered, but it is very precise. And this is comfort. If you go to Roma, in north of Roma, in Civitavecchia, you have a quantum restaurant. This is a true picture. The restaurant is called quantum restaurant. Unfortunately, when I saw it, it was closed. But if I mimic the measurement by a question of being in an Italian restaurant, what do you have? Before ordering, you have amatriciana and carbonara, two types of pasta, right? So the state for you, state of the kitchen, so to speak, is amatriciana plus carbonara. You order something, you expect to have amatriciana or carbonara, and in fact, really, you get exactly one of the dish, amatriciana, or the other one, which was carbonara. So you see, you have a kitchen service, dining room, amatriciana, carbonara, and naively you say you have amatriciana or carbonara, but in fact, you have the same construction with the vector I was doing, and you get one vector or the other vector, and at the quantum level, you have now, if instead of taking Italian dishes, you're a little bit more fancy, you talk about spin, the spin that has been mentioned earlier today, you have spin up and spin down, and you have exactly the same thing, that it's exactly the same. So the important, I mentioned that because the important is the analogy with Italian cooking works well. I'm not sure it works so well with Swiss kitchen, Swiss cooking, but at least for Italian it works well, but I'm not Italian, so I'm not racist. You don't have causality because you get, and you don't know what you order, and you get something, but surely, and you get a precise dish, because amatriciana is something extremely precise. I mean, what I mean like this is that in an Italian cooking, you have a set of distinct dishes. If you go to a kitchen in some other country, you have a continuum of dishes, you know? So you get something approximated to see that. In Italian, it's very clear like this. So you get something which is first very good and which is delicious and very precise. This is important just if you want, forget the joke, you know, I was supposed to try to warming up like this. But there is a part important is that the lack of causality, which in quantum mechanics means that you have random result of your measurements, is totally different than the phenomenon of imprecisions. Quantum mechanics is a more precise science in physics that we never get. It gives you things that you expected with 10 decimals, you know. It's extremely precise and it's random. It's absolutely not incompatible. This comes just from exactly from the fact that you change your paradigm and you forget about the continuum of space that you have in Newton, and you have discrete things because you have vectorial space, you have two-dimensional space, like the up and down spin like this. So it's very important because it's really one of the worst criticisms that people do to quantum mechanics, that it's not precise because you don't know what you get. No, you don't know what you get, but you know that you will get something extremely precise. So this is, I don't know if this kind of consideration about causality exists in biology or not, but it's certainly something extremely characteristic, linked to quantum mechanics. So a measurement deconstruct a little bit like Derrida, the sign plus, because if you have a state which is blah, blah, plus, blah, blah, by measurement, with blah, 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 the plus disappears. The plus is not in our space. The plus is in the context, quantum context, that's nothing to do with us. So you project on components. Voilà, here I just repeat what I said before. But one can say that there is no cause of the result of a measure, because you cannot influence by any means the result you will get. So you can cause. But there is a cause of the fact of measuring. And the fact of measuring, you can say that set of result you can have, and the act really of performing. So the causality, you see, something, I don't know how to explain, I have to say that I failed to try a better explanation, but causality is not between something you do and something you get, but something in this, between something you do and something you can get. That is, making a measurement is an act, something serious, you mean. So this is perfectly causal. The result escape from causality. But, okay, I'm still... fine. Okay, so let me resume exactly what I tried to tell you up to now. I use the word context. I've never used it in quantum mechanics. I got the idea just by reading your resume and all that. But I think it's true that we have two contexts in quantum mechanics. The context, which is the one of the Schrödinger equation, the one of the evolution of your wave function, it's perfectly Newtonian. It's the causality of quantum, of classical physics, perfectly. And the one of measurement, we have no causality. More precisely, the Schrödinger context is epistemologically Newtonian. The context of measurement is epistemologically non-Newtonian. We cause the act of measurement, but nothing causes the result. The result is not the effect of the cause. So measurement is an effect of the cause, but the result is not an effect of the cause. Okay, so there is more. And what is more is the phenomenon. And I want to talk about that because it's really something also which drives a lot of time to the wrong direction, is the phenomenon of entanglement. And entanglement, with respect to the history of science, is interesting because it's something that for 50 years, everybody wanted to say that it doesn't exist and to avoid. And as soon as somebody showed that it exists, everybody wants to show that it's everywhere. It was perfect mauvaise foi, I don't know if they say that in English, of the scientists usually. So entanglement is probably like socket chain and Einstein. It's Einstein a little bit, once again, it's a trumpet to wake up everybody. So the traffic light does the job. What is the job? Entanglement, yeah, so suppose you arrive to a crossing of street. You have a traffic light. What do you do? Okay, you look at the traffic light. What I maintain is that the way you're looking is measuring the traffic light. Because you see, what you say, if the traffic light is red, you say the traffic light is red. It's not the traffic light which is red. It's the red part of the traffic light which is the light. But you associate the property to the traffic light. You don't say that it's part of the traffic light. And you stop. And if it's green, you pass. And why do you pass? You pass because you know that if it's green for you, it's red for the other. And especially if you're in Switzerland, that's true in south of France or in Italy, the other will stop. That's right. This is the entangled thing. That is, the result of the traffic light is either green for you, red for the other, either red for you, and green for the other, otherwise it wouldn't pass. This is exactly the phenomenon of entanglement. Once again, of course, inside the traffic light, there is a little machine which turns and which alternates red for us, green for the other, with the other, which is the green for us and red for the other. But it's not at all the way we're thinking about. When you arrive to the traffic light, for example, if you go to the airport, you have a plane to catch, you're late. If it's red, you said, first of all, something I won't say, and then you say, I'm not lucky. But it has nothing to do with luck. It has nothing to do with random. But you perceive it exactly like if he was, by looking at the traffic light, making a measurement in the sense of a thing, and randomly you get something. And if you're unlucky, you get randomly the red. So if I try to formalize, okay, this is exactly what I said. That's green, I don't repeat because it's easier to read than to speak, to say. Now, the or will be, I think you understand what I said, it's exactly the plus, well, how was it before, dead or alive, right? Now, what is the end? The end is between, now we have two parties, you know, we have us and the other, us and them. So you have to match them in a sentence. And then you match sense exactly to this tensorial product, to this multiplication like this. So I pass here. No, I pass here just to tell you that, yeah, that in quantum mechanics, when you have several particles, you take the tensorial product and not the direct product. So it's a little bit technical, but that you do in classical mechanics. The difference between this is that if you take the tensorial product of two-dimensional objects, you get something four-dimensional. The number two is a pain in the neck for mathematicians, because 2 + 2 is equal to 2 × 2 is equal to 2 × 2 × 2. All that makes 4. In fact, what we have to see is this 4 is 2 × 2 × 2. That is, if you have n vectors like this that you take, we take 2 to the n. What does it mean? Does it mean that if you take 100 classical bits, I mean 100 bits in your computer, you get 100 pieces of information. Information is quotation mark. Don't get nervous because I use the word information
on a computer.
On a computer. Now, if you take 100 quantum qubits, the dimension of the space is not going to be 200 like if it would be for the classical bits. It would be 2 to the 100, and 2 to the 100 is bigger than the number of Avogadro. This means that if you realize a quantum computer with only 100 qubits, which is ridiculous in principle, if it's a bit way classical, you get the possibility of stocking all the information of 1 liter of gas, which is an enormous quantity of things. So you see that this change of paradigm is extremely powerful, depending on what you're going to do with this, these powerful things which tell you that the multiplication increases extremely fastly. Having two spins together is very different than having two coins you flip exactly. You know, it's very, very different. Up to now, people can do quantum computer with only, I think, 3 or 4 bits. So we are still very far from this, but I wanted to give you this order of magnitude. So I go back to this. So what's a traffic light? It's exactly something which is in the state, which is written in red. And when you arrive, you measure. And what you get is either the first factor, green for you, red for the other, either the contrary, and we stop. But in fact, why do we stop if it's green for you, for us? It's you pass when it's green for us because you're sure that it's red for the other. This means that, you know, if you do a measurement of green plus red, etc., we make a measurement, we get green and red. What you expect is that if they look, they will see only red, surely, you know. And this is exactly what's happening with this kind of entangled state. That is, it seems that the second measurement, the measurement done on the second object, is correlated to the first one, and it is. That is, if my traffic light was green, the traffic light for the other will be red, surely. And it seems that, of course, taking about transmission of information, and now I put quotation mark, for traffic light is completely stupid. But if you change green and red into spin up and spin down, like we did before, what you get is that, exactly, I just rewrite what I just wrote before, you get this fact that if I measure the spin up, I'm sure that the other will measure the spin down. Well, not big deal. Except that entangled state like this, people have done experimentally, and it's actually in Switzerland, Geneva, and they have performed this kind of state with two spins And one, so the Zanon spins are in fact photons with polarization. This is exactly the same thing that spin. And they send one of the photons, they keep one photon in Geneva and send the other photon in Zurich. And then they make the measurement. And you know that surely something which is at, I don't know how far is Geneva from Zurich, let's say 200 kilometers, maybe something like this. 200 kilometers far away, you still have transmission of something because you're sure that on the other side you will take the spin down if you got the spin up. So this kind of things was one of the fake paradox of quantum mechanics, saying that you know you have transmission of information with an infinite speed. So breaking the credo by Einstein that you cannot propagate information faster than the speed of light. You know? But in fact, it's not true. You don't transmit information because you see, if you measure your spin, you see down, you never know that you were sure to get down. You see, it's so stupid, but it's exactly like this, you know. Well, you say, well, I got down, maybe I have a probability one half to get one. You never can prove you were sure, except if you are, if you're doing a full set of measurements and then to do some statistics. But if you do some statistics, then you transmit information, but much slower, the paradox is not true. You know, it's like exactly like if you, so if you hammer a nail, voilà, if you hammer a nail and you hurt your finger with it, I don't know if you did that, there's always somebody behind you saying, I was sure this was going to happen. But in fact, no, it was true. And what you did, usually you put the hammer on the face of the person who's taking that. Okay, so there is no transmission of information and by this entanglement. In fact, let me resume this and I will be finished very quickly now. In fact, there is a transmission of something, but once again, on the purely quantum context, the context you don't have access to. But to our, the measurement context, which is your context, because you cannot do it, there is no transmission of information. Okay, so now very quickly, because I think I have about 5 minutes. 5 minutes exactly will be enough. Something which has been very used lately, but I will go very fast, is to link measurements to the result of a measurement. You can create a dynamics, and this is important for causality. You can create a dynamics on a quantum system by saying the following thing. You make a measurement. Depending on the result you get randomly, you will make another measurement. If you take spin up, you will measure some other things, because measurement, you can measure spin, you can measure position, so you can measure spin which are rotated, a full set of measurements you can make. So depending on the result, you make another measurement, and so on, depending on the new result. So you create like this dynamics, which has been used because it's very stable. Something I forgot to say. You see, quantum mechanics is something looking at microscopic stuff, but it's in a stability incredible. Because you know when I said that one of the person physicists was sending the photon from Geneva to Zurich, he didn't put the photon in a car or in a plane and take a plane. They just send the photon through the line of Swiss Telecom. Like exactly, you use the line of the telephone and you send the photon like this, and the photon with all these people saying, where are you, where are you? The photon is still entangled with the first one. It's incredibly stable, you know. Since I have a lot of sense of humor, what they say is that in fact they use the Swiss telecom twice, one to send the photon and the second to put the telephone to tell you the result, to measure, you know. But this is also a particularity of quantum mechanics, is that it's extremely stable. So by this way, you know, you can perfectly imagine a dynamics like this. And then it seems that you have the non-causality, this is what I was mentioning. The non-causality creates a type of causality because then the causality is in the fact that the result is random, but the way of associating a new measurement to the result, this is perfectly causal. So you can create some causality, but I cannot say too much here. And finally, the quantum Zeno effect, and that also I will go fast. Just one say that in principle, you have a state which should arrive to another state,
because you do the dynamics for that, equivalent to the arrow leaving Zeno and going to the wall. But if you look at the arrow very, very frequently, an infinite number of times, that is, you make an infinite number of time measurements, then the arrow never arrives, that is, the state never arrives to the final state. This is a computation, kind of easy, but it's an effect which is not at all, how would I say, not at all obvious. And the other thing is that when I say that you don't have cloning, is that, you know, suppose that you start the second one by a state which is a state phi times the state which is at the origin, nothing, and you would like to transform this by cloning the first one on the second one. That is, you would arrive to phi phi by taking from phi zero, run to phi phi. And you would like to do the same with the psi thing. And this is impossible in quantum mechanics. In fact, this is a result of algebra because everything is in matrix 4x4. It doesn't exist, the matrix 4x4, we just this. And this is also a particularity of quantum mechanics that even with the matrix, it's just a table of numbers that you put like this. And even with very low dimension, like 2x2 matrices or 4x4 matrices, you get theorem which are not obvious to prove, it's difficult to prove this, although it seems completely unobvious. Okay. The only way of cloning a state is to perform a measurement, because then you see, you know that possibly you will get that and you will get the state you wanted, but this will be only random. Okay, so in form of a conclusion, alors, quantum biology, some facts. Are there some? Alors, I put some very, very naive, even more naive than I am, just to make a provocation to the biologists here. So let me resume in one sentence. If there is any causality in quantum mechanics, it is not a causality which would be cause context dependent, because you have a full causality in the quantum context, but then the causality is in a certain sense entangled between two contexts, the context of measurements and the context of the quantum evolution by the Schrödinger equation. So it's something, I mean, maybe it's not understandable, but this is the best I could do. I don't understand myself, but there is this causality, which is, since you mentioned several times that the causality depends on the context, here there is a causality which is in a certain sense in between two contexts. That's the thing. How do we separate the two contexts? I mean, what means to make a measurement? To make a measurement is to use an apparatus of measurements. An apparatus of measurement is something that the only thing you know about it is the fact it's macroscopic. It's a question of size. And there is no, the quantum theory won't tell you a threshold when you make a quantum system more and more large, more and more structured, bigger and bigger, in such a way that when these apparatus will behave in the quantum context just following the Schrödinger equation, or it will become a measurement apparatus. It's something that people try to do, but there is no way. That is, in a certain sense, the quantum theory is not closed with respect to that, because you don't know, you need to decide from the outside when a quantum system is an apparatus, a system of measurements or not. Maybe there is a link between something which concerns the evolution biology, where we treat mostly to macroscopic things, and microbiology, or I use microbiology, I would say biology, molecular biology, which is not very popular here, you know, and the way that I think people from molecular biology would like that all the biology belongs to this and to everything biology, exactly like some people think that a measurement should be a consequence of the Schrödinger equation. But it's not, I believe it's not, there is something completely separated. So it's a fight maybe we have to do together, and I would like to finish with a famous sentence, revolutionary in progress. Okay, that's all. Thank you.